Well, hi, and welcome once again to our Bible studies here at Bible Talk.
Hallelujah.
Here, this time, being in the Orlando, Florida area in Altamont Springs. And as you may notice, our brother Mark is with us again.
Hooray. Hello.
For the first time in about 8 months since we've come.
Long time.
Last time was just before we left the United States. It was in March, it was the last time we filmed together. Mm. So it's good to... Good for us to be back together.
Have you back, have us back with you.
Yeah. Amen. So we're continuing on in our study in Paul's letter to the Romans.
Yes.
And this, I believe, is our 44th study in Paul's letter to the Romans.
Yes, it is.
And I've been saying this for, I think, a couple of months now. We're getting close to the end here. Yeah, well, we are.
One more chapter. Yeah. Now, that could take...
Yeah, well, we're going to finish this chapter 15, because we left off in our last study at Romans 15, verse 19, is where we ended up. So we'll start this time at Romans 15, verse 20. But before we do that, I'm going to ask Brother Mark here to ask God's blessing upon our time together.
Oh, Lord, we thank you for the ability for us to get together and for the pleasure of each other's company.
Amen.
All four of us, you being one. And Lord, just bless us to hear your voice and to understand your word. Amen.
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 Thank you, Jesus.
And it is good for us to be back together.
Yes,
and
yes.
As I said, this is our 44th part. If you've missed any of those studies, they're all available here on the Bible Talk site. So you can go back and watch some again. If you've missed any, you can see them. You can invite others to participate and come watch them. Because they will stay up on the website, as have our previous Bible studies.
Yes.
I think we have the full Bible study up on the Sermon on the Mount. And we have a Bible study up online on prayer and 1 Thessalonians. So there's Bible studies.
Awesome. Yeah.
Because you want to spend time studying the Word. Study to show yourself approved unto God, Paul said to Timothy. All right, so we're at Romans chapter 15. And yeah, I'm sure you've got your Bibles. Maybe you had a pencil and paper or something to make notes. You want to test everything that I say against what the Word of God says. I'm not looking to say original stuff. But we all need to be led by the Holy Spirit who is sent to lead us into all truth.
Amen.
Okay? Mm-hmm. Romans chapter 15, verse 20. I'm going to read verse 20 and 21 to start out, right? And thus I aspire to preach the gospel, not where Christ was already named, so that I would not build on another man's foundation. But as it is written, they who had no news of him shall see, and they who have not heard shall understand. Paul didn't desire to build on another man's foundation, because as he had said, for no man can lay a foundation other than the one which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. That's 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 11. Christ is the foundation. He's the cornerstone. He is the foundation. All ministry has to be built on Jesus Christ. But Paul is not saying that everybody's ministry has to stand apart and alone. Right? He wrote to Timothy, and he said, Timothy is his son in the faith. He discipled Timothy, right?
Mm-hmm.
The things which you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, and trust these to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. 2 Timothy 2:2. So he's telling Timothy, he had instructed Timothy in the Word of God. He had discipled him. Now he's saying, okay, take what you've learned from me and pass it along to others. You don't have to be original in everything. It doesn't have to be your ministry, okay? But that was the call of God on Paul's life. That was the nature of his, all right? We're one body. One Lord, one faith, one baptism. That's what Paul said. So, you know, it's not that he's saying that it's wrong for him to be participating in somebody else's ministry. It was just, this is the call of God in his life, that he would do this, right? Without doubt, Paul, who had at one time been Saul of Tarsus and had only desired to stop the gospel, right?
That's right.
Now, with the mind of Christ and the heart of the Father, his only desire is to spread the gospel. And for all men, you know, Peter wrote to the Father, God desires that none should perish, but all come to everlasting life, right? That was the heart of Paul. And so Paul here, he's expressing, he has a desire for all men to hear, to understand, and to receive the love and grace of God. That was the passion of Paul's life. It was the call of God in Paul's life. So, he wanted to stop the gospel. Now his only desire in life is to spread the gospel. But it's not so much that he had changed his mind, as much as it is that God had changed his heart. Okay? Once God changed his heart, then he changed his mind. Because that's the very definition of repentance. The Greek word for repentance is metanoia, means to change your mind. But that has to follow God changing your heart. It has to start in the heart. It doesn't start in the mind, right?
Absolutely.
Paul wrote, you know, we studied this some time back here in this letter to the Romans. Paul talks about it, we call it Roman dynamite, Romans 10, 9 and 10. You believe in your heart and then you confess with your mouth, right? It starts in the heart.
One of the things about the heart in when, let's see, who was the king after David?
After David, Solomon.
Solomon, what was the one thing that Solomon is most famed for?
Well, his wisdom.
That's what he asked for. But he said, when God said, I will grant you the wisdom, he didn't say he put it in his mind. He said he put it in his heart.
Well, it is all about, God searches the heart. It is all about our heart. And the heart is not just this flesh organ that's pumping. It's the core. As a matter of fact, that happens to be the Latin, the French, the Italian word for heart. For heart is core, C-O-E-R, right? Because it's the core of your being. That's what the spiritual appraisal of this is. So when God changes your, God touches your heart. However, he's a God of free choice. You know, it says in Deuteronomy that he sets before us life and death. And then he says, choose life. God gives us free choice, but he always tells us the right choice to make, right? So he touches our heart, and then we have to decide to change our mind.
He said he was going to take the heart of stone
and give us the heart of flesh. In Jeremiah.
Because it was dead, and then he made it alive.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Because he brought us from death into life.
That's right.
It starts with the heart. This is why, even though God touches our heart, and that's what salvation is all about, is that heart, we repent and come to new life. But even then, once you're saved, you have to be transformed by the renewing of your mind. The renewing of your mind is constantly changing your mind.
So, it's, okay, where is free will in this if God changes your heart? But he does it at his beckoning, and you have to respond to it.
He touches your heart, yes. He gives, you know, David prayed, create me a clean heart. Change my heart. Now, that's a beautiful song. I think Don Mullen wrote it, I'm not sure. Change my heart, O Lord, O God. I love that song. But God, he touches us with his grace, with his love and his grace. All men have the opportunity, all mankind, right? That's men, women, boys, and girls, right?
Those predestined.
Yes, because it says, this is the great message of the gospel, is for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever will.
And he knows whosoever will choose him. He knows who's going to choose him.
Well, he knows, because our names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life from before the foundations of the earth. So he foreknows who will make that choice. But it's still your choice. I mean, this is a great debate between Calvinism and Arminianism, all right? Where does free will come in and play a part in all of this? God gives us that free choice, but he touches it. It's his choice to touch us with his love and his grace. We have to respond to that. After all, I mean, it says in the Word that we love him because he first loved us. Okay? You know, that's why I think I've said this before, I don't know, in this Bible study, years and years and years ago, back in the mid-70s, I remember a campaign called I Found It, which was an evangelistic campaign. And, you know, I think it was Campus Crusade that ran in that. I'm not positive of that. And I don't mean to demean that at all, but I just, you know, I just was troubled by the idea. I found it. We didn't find God.
And he
found us.
He found us.
We were the ones who were lost. He was never lost. So he came to seek and to save that which was lost, right? So it's because of his action. It is always, God is the prime mover. Nothing happens without the action of God first, right? So God has touched us and placed before us. He sent his son. He sent his love into the world. And he publicly displayed him, is what the word says, right? Paul writes that, that Jesus was publicly displayed. That's God's love being publicly displayed. For all mankind to see, right? So we're touched by that love of God. Some people accept it, some people reject it. Because while God's love is unconditional, there is a condition to us receiving that love. And that is the surrendering of ourselves.
Total surrender. He wants all.
Yeah.
All of our heart.
But it's surrendering that old self.
Yes.
So he can make us be what he desires us to be. I mean, this is all in Romans. You know, in Romans chapter 8, we just talked about it. Whom he foreknew, he predestined. In other words, he foreknows what choice we'll make.
Exactly.
And based on that is his predestination. But what he predestined us for, it says in Romans 8, for whom he foreknew, he predestined to be conformed into the image of his son, Christ Jesus. Right. This is taking us back to that place in the very, very beginning. In the beginning, God created, when God wanted to make man in his own image. The fact is, sinful man, after, you know, born out of the natural, out of Adam, sinful Adam, we don't look like Jesus.
And that's why he told Nicodemus,
you must
be born again.
You must be born.
Must.
That is one of the key verses. You know, there's a handful of key verses.
That's
you know, he says you must. Whenever it says you, anything must happen, you know, you should really look at that and try to understand what's going on.
Yeah.
That's true. That's
Absolutely.
A good point. You know, when you see, you must, that's, okay. So, there's a reason for that, because when you're born again, it's not like God takes the old you and just kind of dusts you off and cleans you up.
Creation.
You are a new creation in Christ Jesus, is what Paul says. So, but that's because now, instead of being the child of Adam, fallen Adam, bearing his sin after his kind, you are now born of your Father above. You are born of God the Father, who is a spirit, right?
Yes.
So you come out clean. Now the thing is, we come out, and you know, we've talked about this a lot, and I don't know that we can over-talk about it, is the difference between Christ being resurrected and coming out of that tomb that held him in new life. Lazarus came out, but there was a difference.
Yes.
Lazarus came out wearing the grave clothes. Whereas Jesus left him behind in the tomb. No, it was not an empty tomb. Because the grave clothes were left in it. Lazarus came out wearing the old clothes of death, the grave clothes. And we come into this new life wrapped in those old grave clothes, in our old habits, our old traditions, our old way of thinking. And this is why when we come into new life, we still have to be transformed by the renewing of our mind. Now, if repentance means changing your mind, that process of being transformed is a constant repentance.
That's right, yeah.
It's changing your way of thinking. Mm-hmm. Because you were trained by the world to think like the world. Now you have to be trained by the Word of God. Remember, Jesus is the Word made flesh who dwelt among us. You are being trained by the Word to walk and live according to the Word and the fullness of God's Word, His promise.
I was just thinking about the fact that when someone tells you something and you believe them, and then you find out they were lying to you, you can't trust anything they say from that point.
Absolutely, you shouldn't trust anything they say.
So before we knew Jesus, we were believing the traditions or whatever, and then we found out those traditions were lying to us. So we shouldn't be trusting anything from that.
You don't have those little cards, the preliminary card with you, do you?
No, I don't.
Okay.
Sorry.
That's right. Alice has a couple little cards that we can show an optical illusion. That's, we won't go into that now. So the point of all of this is that we need to start walking in the newness of life, and that comes from a transformed mind, an ongoing process, right? And that starts, you're not going to ever change your mind. You're never going to have that. It's by the grace of God that we repent.
Yes.
That's what it says, right? So it's God changing our heart and us being open to receive that change, not rejecting Him, not resisting Him, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's the deal. You are either going to, respond to Him or you're going to resist Him. Yes. When you hear the good news of Jesus Christ. Now bear in mind that we're talking about the Apostle Paul. He was the absolute enemy of the work of Jesus Christ as Saul of Tarsus.
Yes,
he was a Pharisee among the Pharisees, right? And he was out to persecute the church.
Mm-hmm.
He encountered the risen Jesus Christ on the road to Damascus. And he surrendered to Christ on that road and to Christ's purpose in his life. So once God changed his heart, he changed his mind, and everything was different. Everything in your life should be different.
That's right.
I mean, B.J. Thomas sang a song years ago about what a difference, you know, talking about the Lord, what a difference you've made in my life. If you have new life in Jesus Christ, you'd have a new lifestyle in Jesus Christ.
Absolutely.
And that new lifestyle is an evolving. That's maybe not a great term to use.
Growing?
Growing, yeah. It's
or a cleansing?
Well, it's a transforming, because we have been so trained by the world to think like the world that what I'm saying is that, I don't think we think of it in these terms. We're constantly changing. We should be constantly changing the way we think. Transferring from what the world has taught us to what the Word teaches us.
What does the world teach us? What kind of wisdom is it?
Earthly, natural, and demonic, James.
So what should ours be? Just the opposite of that.
From wisdom from above. That's what James says. There's two types of wisdom.
Wisdom from above.
In the letter of James, go check it out. It says that there is wisdom from above. That's a godly wisdom, which God gives freely to all men, right?
It shouts in the street.
Right? Wisdom stands in the street and shouts, it says in Proverbs.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And there is the alternative. And that is wisdom that James says is earthly, natural, and demonic. Not three different wisdoms. That
adjectives
is wisdom.
One wisdom.
That's three adjectives.
Earthly,
natural, and demonic. And that's the way you were trained.
Wisdom of the world.
Now, the thing is, for a lot of us, that's a harsh reality and hard to deal with.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's saying, well, you know, prior to the moment you got saved, there's only one word to describe you. Stupid.
That's right.
Is that an adjective?
Well, you see, I have no desire to be politically correct. I have a desire to be speaking the word. And if you find that offensive, do remember that Christ is the rock of offense over which men stumble. Because that's what the Word of God says. It says in Jeremiah chapter 10, it says, all mankind is stupid and devoid of knowledge. You come into this world in the natural stupid. You come into this, you don't know anything. You know nothing. The only thing you could do is cry and scream. I mean, that's all you
that's
were
all
good
we
for
did.
When you popped out.
That's all we did.
This is a Bible study.
I would have thought of another adjective, like a sinner, demonic, something like that.
But it's true. What do you know when you were born into this world? Nothing. Think
you're
about
self-centered.
This. You are totally self-centered. As a matter of fact, we were talking about this the other day with somebody. I'm trying to think of how to put this, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Bear with me a minute. Nelson Mandela, in the week that we are recording this,
a spider
on me. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's smooshed all over there now.
Oh, am I going to start swinging from building to building here now? Okay. All right. Nelson Mandela passed away, a week ago now, right?
Yeah.
Something like that, yeah.
And they just had the services or the memorial for him over in South Africa. And so obviously much has been written about Mandela.
Mm-hmm.
and he has certainly a lot to look at. But one of the things that he said, probably many, many times in his life after he was released from prison in South Africa, was how when you're born, children are born, and they don't know hatred. Nobody comes out, no black person comes out hating white people, no white person comes out hating black people, that kind of thing. And he's saying you have to be taught that. Yeah. Well, in effect, you don't have to be taught that. Yeah. Now, he's not really wrong, but
you have to take to it.
No. You don't come out hating.
No.
The problem is not, the hatred is not the root. Love of self is the root. When a baby is born, that baby comes out, there is nothing but himself or herself. That's all life is at that moment in time. They have no concern for anybody else. They don't care about mommy. Mommy is just, a source. Mm-hmm. Mommy has been a source. That baby, when it comes out, and yes, that baby was alive, that baby was a being, a human being in mother's womb. But that baby was totally, absolutely, completely dependent upon the mother. It had no ability to do anything for itself, right? Mm-hmm. Now when that baby comes out, it's still totally dependent.
Yes.
And it wants attention. That baby comes out crying and screaming. What is natural to man is not hatred. What is natural to man is love of self.
That's true.
That's the root of the problem. It says in Proverbs chapter 6, six things does the Lord hate, yea, even seven are an abomination. Haughty eyes is the first one, pride. It's about love of self. Paul, writing to Timothy, 2 Timothy chapter 3, he talks about the perilous last days. And the first thing he says about those perilous last days is men will be lovers of self. It's not so much that you hate others, it's that you love yourself. And when you love yourself, you don't care about others. I do a seminar. I've been doing a seminar on biblical principles in the workplace for 22 years now. And I actually do a session that is called Caring Less About Carelessness, right? Mm-hmm. And, it says an unjust balance is an abomination to the Lord. It says that twice in the book of Proverbs. Well, a balance, when they're talking about a balance in Scripture, they're talking about those old scales, like the scales of justice, balances, mm-hmm. right? So if you look at your love of self and love of others, okay, if you are totally devoted to love of self and that rises, well, the love of others goes down. The more you care about yourself, the less you will care about others. And listen, because this is the truth, the more you care about others, the less you're going to care about yourself.
I almost wonder which is worse, hatred or apathy?
Well, the apathy comes, apathy and hatred are, this is what I'm saying, they're entirely interlocked. Because if you are filled with love for yourself, you are apathetic about the well-being of others. You only care about how they affect your life. How do they benefit you?
Yeah. Are you familiar with what is going on in these big cities now, the hidden game?
Yes.
Where people come in and just slug you, mm-hmm. and they don't know you, they're apathetic toward you. You're just a punching bag. Mm-hmm.
But,
and they don't hate you.
It's the violence.
It's not about you, it's about them. Mm-hmm. So that's the point.
Yeah.
It's not about their victim. They don't care about the victim. The victim is a non-entity.
It's the thrill that they get.
The victim is non-human. Yeah. It's all about themselves. They're proving something about themselves. They are seeking some kind of self-gratification, self-glorification. Yeah. It's all about self. And this is what leads to that place. I was thinking about it today. I mean, you turn on the news or read a newspaper today. Today, as we're filming this, it is December 13th, 2013. Mm-hmm. You turn on the news and it is just filled with violence after violence after violence after violence.
They just had a school shooting.
It was a football game. There was a riot and people killed at a football game. It's everywhere. That's not about hate. It doesn't begin with hatred. Mm-hmm. It begins with love of self. Don't be mistaken about this. And don't think that this is something unimportant. All right? Because again, the scripture, the warning is pride.
Yes.
The warning is love of self. Because when you truly love yourself, you just simply don't care about anybody else. And it's not so much hatred of them.
No.
Except that, you know, you just, they're in your way. They're not you. They don't meet your standard. They don't do what you want. They don't serve you the way you want, right? So you can't overstate the importance of God's word that says we are to humble ourselves, which is the opposite of pride. Because when we humble ourselves, and the great example of that is Jesus Christ, who humbled himself to the point of death, even death on a cross, right? This is the King of Kings. It is that place when God can exalt us and do the work he wants in us. So it is all about this, but it comes, you don't have the ability to do that without the grace of God. You don't have the ability to do that without the power of the Holy Spirit in your life. You don't have the ability in and of yourself
to do
this. But you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. It's all about your relationship with God. It's all about your relationship with Jesus Christ. That's what Paul knew. And, I mean, this is the example of the change. Here you have a man whose entire life was dedicated to stopping the church.
Yes.
And in an instant, on that road to Damascus, he became a man whose only desire in life was to build or work with God, for God, in the building of the kingdom of God. Okay?
Hallelujah.
All right, let's go on to the next verse. Verse 22. I'm going to read 22 through 24. So, for this reason, I have often been prevented from coming to you. But now, with no further place for me in these regions, and since I have had for many years a longing to come to you whenever I go to Spain, for I hope to see you in passing, and to be helped on my way there by you, when I have first enjoyed your company for a while. Now, remember, Paul had mentioned in the beginning of this letter, in the first chapter, that his plans to get to Rome had been disrupted. Right? But it's evident that the Lord's plans are never disrupted. God's plans are never thwarted. Right?
That's right.
Paul was often led. He had direction by circumstance. God says, you know, he will lead us in paths of righteousness for his name's sake in Psalm 23. But oftentimes, we get direction by circumstance.
That happened to us today, this morning.
That happened to us today.
Yes.
The better example is when you went alone to Africa. You were prevented from going into one country.
Yeah.
Then you were then in another instance, you were trying to get to a church, and you thought you had found the church. The minister let you preach, then you found out it was the wrong church.
Yeah, absolutely.
It was God, an answer to a pastor's prayer.
Yeah.
And God did all of that to answer
to get us to where we were.
And you never did meet the pastor that you stiffed.
Yeah.
I wouldn't have said that I stiffed him, but I would say yes. We
that you missed.
But by the way, just put a little plug in here. The account of that is in our online book on our website, BibleTalk.com. It's called Sweet Wine in the Morning, The Breakfast of Champions. And that's one of the little testimonies, one of the little chapters. We were in Cameroon. I was in Cameroon with a buddy of mine, and we were traveling around. I was preaching, and we were supposed to go to Gabon. We got to the border of Gabon. We ran into problems with the border guards and got diverted. Now, it had been our plan to go there, but it had not been God's plan for us to go there, other than the fact that we certainly brought the gospel to some people on the border.
Mm-hmm.
But because of that, we turned around and traveled all the way back up the other side of the country. And the fellow I was with, Arnold, had called and made arrangements with a pastor in this small village on just on the other side of Mount Cameroon for me to preach. And we got there, and the story is, I mean, on that Sunday morning in the midst of rain and storm and everything, we walked into this church, and Arnold said to this pastor as we walked in, "Alan's here to preach." And the guy got all excited, said, "Okay, go ahead, go do it." And I preached, and we had a blessed time. And at the end of it, we found out I wasn't in the church that we thought we were in. But I was in exactly the right place at exactly the right time. But God had directed us by circumstance. That happens.
Yeah, like that, I said this morning.
Yeah, but, and that happened a lot in Paul's life.
Yes.
Okay? Paul had intended, and this is not the only time that Paul had said that he had been prevented from getting someplace that he wanted to go. Mm-hmm. This happened in Asia a few times. I'm sure it was not Paul's intention to go with Silas to minister to a jailer in Philippi in a rotten, dark, deep dungeon. That hadn't been his plan. God directed him by circumstance to get in that place where not only was the jailer saved, but his entire family was saved.
That's right.
Paul, when he was getting to Rome, finally, got diverted and wound up on the island of Malta. You know the story of the shipwreck in Acts chapter 27.
That was a big diversion.
Yes, and people all over that island got saved because Paul brought the good news of Jesus Christ to that place. That was direction by circumstance. So that happens, and we have to be open to this leading of the Holy Spirit.
Be aware of it.
And God worked mightily through the snake bite.
Absolutely, yes, he did.
Absolutely.
Yes, he did.
But, you know, in Thessalonians, Paul wrote, and he said, for we wanted to come to you, talking about the Thessalonians.
Yes.
I, Paul, more than once, and yet Satan hindered us. He had gone to Thessalonica initially, proclaiming the word boldly in the face of much opposition, it says, as a result of the situation that had happened in Philippi.
Right.
So, you know, it's like, I think a lot of times we think that the leading of the Spirit of God is, okay, you get a letter from this congregation, we'd love you to come and be our chief
speaker,
pastor. But it doesn't always work that way. And oftentimes, you don't even know what God is doing until the end of the matter. The end of the matter, it says in Ecclesiastes, is better than its beginning. What it boils down to is your trust in God. And that you're trusting that he is leading you. And Paul had that. You know, Peter said it. He said, beloved, don't be surprised at the fiery ordeal that comes upon you for your testing. These things happen. Many of the afflictions of the righteous, it says in the Psalms. Peter says we should not be surprised. We know that the enemy is going to do everything that he can to try and prevent us from living the fullness of God's call in our lives. He's going to. He comes as a thief. He comes to steal. He comes to rob. He comes to kill. That's what Jesus said. It shouldn't surprise us that he's trying to do this. Okay? However, you have to know what God said. When he spoke through Isaiah, talking about everybody that opposes him in his plan, and he said, devise a plan, but it will be thwarted.
That's right.
State a proposal, but it will not stand, for God is with us.
Hallelujah.
This is Paul. I mean, this is the heart of Paul when in Romans chapter 8 here, he proclaimed, we know that all things work together for good for those who love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. If God is for us, who can be against us? It comes to that place when you have that assurance by faith in your life that you will walk in the triumph of Christ Jesus just like Paul did.
Because you'll be giving thanks and praise
for all things. You know, we were talking about that. We were out yesterday with a pastor buddy of mine, Robert Dunlap, over at Winter Park Church. We had some lunch and fellowship with him. And we were talking about this because it's what God had been putting on his heart. And I was sharing with him how this has been something I taught a lot about when we were in England and Wales.
Well, you've been saying
I've been teaching it for years, yes.
Yeah.
But I've said, you know, it is really this simple. People would come to me and say, oh, pastor, I want to know what God's will is for me. And I said, oh, that's simple. It says it. Give thanks in all things, for this is the will of God for you in Christ Jesus.
How much clearer can that be?
There you are. This is God's will for you. Oh, no, you know, that's not what I mean. I mean it. No, no. You know what? Start giving him thanks and praise right now.
That's right.
That you trust in his leading you, however he chooses to lead you. That he is in control. And his plans can't be thwarted. Start giving him thanks for that, and you will see God's will for you clearly. He's a God of revelation. He doesn't hide. You know, as Alice mentioned before, wisdom stands in the street and shouts, it says. The Lord roars from Zion. He is a God of revelation. He doesn't hide the truth.
No.
He bursts forth with the truth.
That's right.
He sent the truth into the world. His name is Jesus Christ.
And he never fails. Never.
Absolutely. He doesn't fail.
Never.
Now, that doesn't mean that we don't fail him.
But
look at this verse here that we're talking about now. Because, you see, it was Paul's expectation that on his travels, he would be helped on his way by the saints, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's a reasonable expectation based on the words of Jesus Christ as he was sending the apostles out. Think about this. And as you go, preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. Freely you receive, freely give. Do not acquire gold or silver or copper for your money belts, or a bag for your journey, or even two coats or sandals or a staff, for the worker is worthy of his support. Those are the words of Jesus Christ. It's in all the Gospels, the three synoptic Gospels. But I'm reading from Matthew chapter 10, right? This was the instruction of Jesus. You're going to walk in faith. If you're going to go out and preach my gospel, my good news, this is what he's saying. You're going to go out and you're going to do it in faith.
Yes.
Without faith, it's impossible to please God. And yet, I don't say this in condemnation, but I know, and I hear so many people, Alice and I have been doing missionary work, one form or another, for almost 40 years now. Mm-hmm. We know that what God calls us to do, he will provide for us to do.
Yes.
And he will provide one way or the other.
Yes.
But it's not like, okay, you know, we have to have everything ahead of time.
No.
You have to make the decision first.
That we're going to do it. Because we know he's going to come through.
Yes.
And then
trust in him to provide.
Yes.
Now, I use the example, because I think this is, we've had so many experiences of how God has done this.
Yes.
But years ago, we do a lot of ministering. We've done a lot of ministering for the last 10 years, I guess, or close. Yeah, about 10 years. And it started with Africa. When we left, I thought we were going to spend our lives in Latin America and in the Caribbean.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's what I thought. And his thoughts are not my thoughts. My thoughts are, we're getting there. So we wound up in Africa, we wound up in Europe, and we were praying one time, we were here in Orlando, Florida, and we were praying about it. I felt the Lord's leading that we were supposed to go to France. So we were praying about that, because it's not so much that I'm seeking provision for it, because we don't have anything. I mean, you know, if God doesn't supply, we don't have a way to go. And a lot of people say, oh, that's great faith. No, that's a great blessing. Because in a sense, it makes it very difficult to make a mistake.
That's right.
If I had lots and lots of money, if we had lots and lots of reserves, I just, you know, say, I feel like doing this, so I'll go do this.
Yeah.
In our situation, it's got to be God or it doesn't happen.
Mm-hmm.
So we were praying about going to France. We did not have the means to get to France, but I felt God was calling us to do that.
So we said, okay,
well, I just want to be sure, Lord, this is you. So we had gone to a large mall here in Central Florida. It was on a Saturday, and we were sitting in the food court in the mall, and we were having lunch. And we're praying about going to France. Alice went over to Chick-fil-A. I'll tell you the story. Okay. And Alice always gets the children's meal at Chick-fil-A.
Because the portion is perfect.
Okie dokie. And anyhow, at Chick-fil-A, a company owned and run by Christians, by the way, they give you this, every children's meal has a toy, some kind of toy children, something. And Alice had gone over and gotten it, and we're sitting at the table, and she came back with her Chick-fil-A little children's meal, and we're praying, God, do you want us to go to France? And she opens up her meal, and the toy is a CD-ROM of an adult lesson in conversational French. Now, I don't know how many 5-year-olds or 6-year-olds would really enjoy that, but that was the toy that came in her meal as we were sitting there and praying about going to France, and we get a CD-ROM on conversational French.
That's right.
So, not being as thick as that wall, I said, I get it, Lord. So we made a commitment right that moment. We said, okay, we'll go to France. We'll start packing the bags this weekend. Well, that Monday, we went to our post office box, and lo and behold, somebody had mailed us. Now, nobody knew that we were even praying about this.
No.
Somebody had mailed us a check, just as a donation to our ministry. And guess what? It paid for the airplane ticket to France.
Yes, it did.
But we made the decision first.
It was in our hearts.
Yes, the
God
provision.
Our hearts.
Yes. The provision, the willingness to go where he wanted.
That's right.
The provision followed. I hear people saying all the time, well, I'm going to do this, I'm going to earn this money, I'm going to store
but
up this.
I gotta
and
I wait till I get the money.
Well, that just doesn't line up with what Jesus said.
No.
And it surely appears from any study of the New Testament that Paul didn't find it necessary to have massive fundraising campaigns.
No.
or need to sell prayer clause. Now remember, the concept of prayer clause came from Paul in the book of Acts. Yes. I mean, God is using him to do such miracles that people were taking aprons and handkerchiefs from Paul, touching them, and bringing them to the sick and demon-possessed, and God was doing miracles. You know what? I don't believe he charged for a single one.
No.
And you said the New Testament, but the Old Testament had this concept too.
Oh, of course, yeah.
When Moses, you know, they were going through the Red Sea, there's four times they crossed the waters.
Well, he was with the Red Sea.
Waters. Who? Okay, after him.
Joshua.
Yeah. They crossed the Jordan River, I think, four times. And each time he put his foot out and the water receded. Mm-hmm. And another foot, it receded some more. And first the step of faith, then the result, dry ground.
The thing is, this is like the Red Sea, where God expected Moses to step out and then the sea would part. You take the step and God responds. Because it's the word comes, right? And without faith it's impossible to please God. We are supposed to be a people who walk not by sight, but by faith. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. We are supposed to act based on what we have heard from God. You know, I was having this conversation yesterday with Robert. We were talking about giving thanks and everything. And I said, if you look at the Red Sea, the people of God, who had seen the mighty hand of God as he brought these plagues upon Egypt to set them free. Now they're mumbling and grumbling and groaning and complaining because they're confronted with the Red Sea. And Moses says, stand by and see the salvation of God. But they're mumbling and grumbling and groaning. God parts the water, they get to the other side. God closes the water in on the Pharaoh's armies, right? Mm-hmm. And on the other side it says they sang and they danced and they had a jubilee. Well, that sounds nice. And it is, I mean, thank God. We should be giving thanks for what he has done. But I promise you that we better be giving thanks for what he will do.
Before the waters parted,
they should have sang and danced and had a jubilee on the other side of the Red Sea.
Thank you.
Because he had spoken it. And once he speaks it, it is a done deal. If you believe him, if you trust him, if you have faith. But if you have to wait to see the results before you'll give thanks, you have a problem. You have a problem because you are not walking in faith. You are responding to what you have seen. That is not faith. Go read Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. Faith is the assurance of things not seen. Because you've heard from God and you trust him.
Yes.
And again, I'm going to go back. That's what the core of this letter to the Romans is. It's chapter 8. Where this is, Paul knows that nothing can separate him from the love of God.
Mm.
That if God is for him, nobody can be against him. It all goes back to this trust in God. Because that's what's pleasing to God. Let me tell you something. Jesus said it. And these are the days we better be thinking about it and looking at it. Jesus did not say, when I come back, am I going to find big fancy church buildings?
That's not what he said.
He said, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith? Will he find a people who are responding to his word, living by his word, acting according to what he has spoken, or not? That's the question. That's the question he asked, not me. We have to get to this place, all right? We need to be giving thanks for what he's doing. If it is direction by circumstance, you have to be giving thanks no matter what goes on, because you have to be trusting that God watches over his word to perform it. No matter what's going on in your life, he said that he would lead you in paths of righteousness. If you are submitted to God, no matter what the circumstances are, no matter what the devil throws at you, God is in control.
Yes, he is.
God is in control.
Mm-hmm.
This is not, you know, this battle between right and wrong, this battle between good and evil is often portrayed as a battle between equals. It is not. And the first thing you need to know about that battle is it's done.
It's already over.
It's over. Jesus Christ hung on the cross and said, it is finished. The devil has been defeated. That's what the Word of God says. He has been disarmed. Satan has no authority or power over you, believer, whatsoever. Listen to me. If you're sitting out there and you have not accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you're in serious trouble.
Yes.
You're in serious trouble. And there's only one way out, and it's not going to be President Obama that's that one way out. It's not going to be a government. It's not going to be a bank. It's not going to be a doctor. It's not going to be a lawyer. The only way out is Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah. The way, the truth, and the life.
He is the way. So you need to turn your life over, because otherwise Satan is in control of your life. You are bound to him. You are in slavery to him. And you know, Al and I were talking about this today, and I said, you know, it's time that we started getting in people's faces a little more and saying, Jesus Christ said, you are either for me or you are against me.
Life or death.
It is. You know, this is not a game. It really is not a game. This is a matter of life and death. We have turned religion into some kind of pomp and ceremony. Well, just like they did back in ancient Babylon and ever since. But what we're talking about is a matter of life and death, eternal life and death. And we don't want to hurt anybody's feelings. Forget their feelings. Mm-hmm. Their feelings have to die. We need to tell people, boldly tell people, the good news of Jesus Christ. That he died this horrible, horrific death. Nailed to a cross like a common criminal. And you know it says in Isaiah 53 that he had no appearance that we should be attracted to him. It is that horror of the cross that reveals the glory of God and the love of God. We're doing everything to make Christianity pretty, when in fact it is that, like I said, it's that horror that reveals the glory and the beauty. I'm not going to get into the whole thing. I've already mentioned that this is December, about Christmas. We can make Christianity, we try and make Christianity so pretty with all the little bulbs and the trees and the decorations. People say to me, Merry Christmas. My only response is, remember, he was born to die. He was born to die. That's the only reason he came into this world. His destiny was sealed. The minute that God spoke to Mary, the fate of Jesus Christ was sealed. He was born to die. He stood before Pontius Pilate and said, for this reason I have come into this world. He came to die for your sins, for my sins, for our sins. That's why he came here. He came here for that horrible death, so that we would be free from paying that price, because the wages of sin is death.
Thank you, Jesus.
We need to be real about this. You know, if you think that we're going to draw people to that saving power of God the Father with our little Christmas celebrations, I'm just going to say this to you. You are wrong. The Word of God, right here in this letter to the Romans, in his letters to the Corinthians, Paul says, the Word of the cross, the Word of the cross is the power of God unto salvation.
Amen.
You know?
You can't play the game of religion.
I have to say this, I get myself in trouble. I get myself in trouble a lot. I don't, quite frankly, don't care. The fact of the matter is, we have in the New Testament roughly 90 years of history in the New Testament, okay? Mm-hmm. From the birth of Jesus Christ, or from before the birth of Jesus Christ, from before the birth of John the Baptist, up until the book of Revelation, John writing it on Patmos around 90 AD.
Okay.
Not once in all of that 90 years is there any mention or hint of the church celebrating the birth of Jesus Christ. But I'll tell you what the Word of God does say. It says, Paul wrote it, that we are to proclaim his death until he comes. It is the death of Jesus Christ that brings life to you and me. It is the death of Jesus Christ that brings life to those lost sinners out there. He was born to die. Okay. I distract myself as usual. Okay.
Verse now.
Okay. It was also Paul's, we're still in the same verse, I haven't gotten past it. But it was also Paul, I was talking about Paul's expectation, right? It was Paul's expectation that on his travels, he would be helped on his way by the saints. That's a reasonable expectation based on the words of Jesus. Remember, that's what I said.
Mm-hmm.
that you're supposed to go out trusting that God will supply. Well, God supplies. You know what? He can supply. He fed Elijah with a raven, right? Yes. Mm-hmm. He can do that. But that's not his real plan, all right? His plan is that he works through each and every one of us, all right? Mm-hmm. You know, I've said this before, but I'll say it again because it's worthy of repeating. This is my theology, and I pray that it becomes your theology. That if I have a need, I know that God will supply my need, because he watches over his word to perform it, and it says in Philippians chapter 4, the Word of God says, my God shall supply all of your needs through his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. If I have a need, God's going to supply that. Mm-hmm. The deal is that if I have a need, he's going to supply that need. He is more likely to give it to Mark than to me. Right. Well, you say, well, that doesn't make any sense. Well, you know what? God's ways are still not our ways. Mm-hmm. But that's how the body of Christ is supposed to work. Because you see, if God gives it to Mark and it was my need, it wasn't Mark's need. That's an abundance in his life.
Right.
He has something in his life that he doesn't need. It's abundance.
More.
And Paul says that God gives abundance to one to meet the needs of another. So Mark, who loves me, sees my need, and he takes that abundance and gives it to me, just like it says in John. You see your brother in need, right? Now, two of us get blessed.
Yes.
And interestingly, he'll get more blessed than me. Because if you believe Jesus Christ, he said it is more blessed to give than to receive.
Amen.
That's the way the body of Christ is supposed to work. Paul knew that that's the way it's supposed to work. That's the way he expected it to work. Whether it does or not, well, there you go. Romans 15:25, I'm going to start at 25 and 26. We'll keep an eye on the time because I have no idea what time we started. But now I'm going to Jerusalem serving the saints. From Macedonia and Achaia, I have been pleased to make a contribution for the poor among the saints in Jerusalem. Now, let me just go back and reiterate what I said a minute ago. Paul had written to the church at Corinth regarding this offering, right? And this offering is for the believers in Jerusalem. Our graciousness and our help is supposed to start with the household of God. Not that it has to end there, but it's supposed to start there. Paul wrote to the Corinthians and said, each one must do just as he is purposed in his heart, not grudgingly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. So, you know, nobody should be coercing you or selling you on the idea of giving to meet the needs of other saints. You know, that's what I see, basically, if you turn on much of Christian television, what you're going to see is a sales pitch to coerce you to get your money, right? And generally, there's a self-motivation to that. You know, giving, you're going to get more. Give to get. No. You give because you see the need. That's the motivation of Jesus Christ. Not because you want to get more than you have. Now, you deal with that, right? So, we should be eyes open. John said, if you see your brother in need, okay, we're to supply that need. But love of self prevents us from looking at others except as a source for ourselves.
We only see our own needs.
We only see their potential to help our needs. Love is about serving others, giving. Okay, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son. God's not going to force you to give. And if you don't give, shame on you. But if you don't give, you know what? You're harming yourself. The body is supposed to function that way. You know, part of it's a hand, part of it's a mouth, part of it's a stomach. If the stomach is hungry, it takes the hand, takes the feet to walk to where the food is, it takes the hand to lift it up. The whole body has to function together properly. Right? Now, let me move right along here, because Romans 15:27. Yes, they were pleased to do so, and they are indebted to them. For if the Gentiles have shared in their spiritual things, they are indebted to minister to them also in material things. Salvation comes from the Jews. That's what Jesus Christ said. Mm-hmm. Right? That word of God, they were entrusted with the oracles of God, it says. We receive the oracles of God through the Jews. We receive salvation came through the Jews. Okay? If we receive those spiritual treasures, Paul is saying, shouldn't we minister back to them in the material things? The answer is, it's a rhetorical question. The answer is yes, we should be, right? They were pleased to give. Now, it says they were pleased to do so and are indebted to them. But I want you to know the only debt that you owe, the only debt that you're to owe is love, right? Paul had written that. Again, here in Romans, he said, owe nothing to anyone except to love one another. For he who loves his neighbor has fulfilled the law. So the only thing you're supposed to owe is love. But it's love that motivates you to be that cheerful giver. For God so loved the world he gave. Right? So the church should be a body of cheerful givers. Paul said, if we sowed spiritual things in you, is it too much if we reap material things from you? 1 Corinthians 9:11. This is a godly principle that Paul further explained in his second letter to the Corinthians. At this present time, your abundance being a supply for their need, so that their abundance also may become a supply for your need, that there may be equality. You know, equality, we see that in the early church in Acts chapter 2, Acts chapter 4. Now look around you, if you know anything about the church today, you'll see need. We spent time in Kenya, East Africa, on this trip we just got back from. The need is beyond belief. I mean, just incredible need. And yet, we come back here, and we see the waste that goes on here. We here in America need to start speaking to the Lord, or listening to the Lord, about our abundance and their need. Now, I'm not going to come up with a program. You know, that's what Paul was doing. He had come up with a program to meet the needs of the Jews, the Jewish believers back in Jerusalem who were suffering. So he's going around to the Gentile churches and saying, hey, we got to take care of them. Why can't I say to us, you know, the church is all over. They're in such desperate need. And we sit here in our ease and abundance. Is that not self-love? We don't care.
We don't care enough.
We don't care enough. The problem is that principle of giving for equality stands in the face of the prosperity gospel that has found such traction in the Western world.
Yes, that's right.
That when you get abundance, it's all about you. It's all about God's blessing. It's all about God's favor in your life. Now it's all for you. It's all for you. It's not for you. It is for the body.
And that's that self-centeredness of
it. It is absolutely that self-centeredness.
And then that could be going back to saying not only is it stupid, but it's demonic.
It is demonic. It is absolutely demonic. And by the way, I'm going to have to end here soon. But the fact is, I ask this question of a lot of people, and they don't know what is the sin of Sodom. What is the sin of Sodom? You know, Sodom, God blew right off the face of the earth. And the response is always the homosexuality. Which, by the way,
was just a symptom.
That was just a symptom. Right. And it's interesting today with all of the talk in the church and in the world about homosexuality, that maybe it should make us sit up and take notice. The simple fact of the matter is, go read Ezekiel chapter 16, and you will find that the sin of Sodom was not homosexuality. That is a sin that was taking place there, rampant there. But like Mark said, it's a symptom of some greater problem. The greater problem was that self-love. It says that Sodom was at ease, had abundance, but didn't care about her neighbor and their need. We're sitting here in the Western world with such abundance.
And homosexuality is rampant.
Is it?
Yes.
Yeah, I'd say it is.
Yes.
You're being pushed on.
Pushed.
Yes.
Pushed.
Coerced. Okay. So, listen, I'm not asking you to send me money.
No.
No. I'm telling you that you need to be open to God's leading in your life. That if you have abundance, I'm telling you that God gave you abundance to bless somebody else. I am saying that. And you want to know something? in one way or another, every one of us has abundance. You may not have abundance in material things. You may have abundance in spiritual things, which is what Paul just talked about with Jerusalem. The Jews had spiritual abundance. They passed that along. And now material abundance that we have should go back and bless them. That's what he was saying to the churches. We need to look at being used by God. We need to be a blessing. In the early church, there was no need. Acts chapter 2 and Acts chapter 4, the only time you could look at the church and say, and by the way, there was need all around them. Mm-hmm. But it says the early church, there was no need. Why? Because they were all of one mind. They held all things in common. Nobody treated anything as their own. And if they saw a need, they filled that need. And there was no need in the church. You know what? If we have need in the church today, it is not because God has failed. Because you want to know something? God never fails.
Never.
And it is, again, I'm going to say, God will touch your heart, but you have to change your mind. That's where we started, and that's where we're going to end. It is the grace and mercy, the love of God, that will touch your heart and put these things on your heart. But it's got to be your mind that makes a decision to be obedient to the call of God. So, hallelujah. Father, I thank you for that, first of all, that you send your Holy Spirit to lead us into that truth, to open our eyes to the truth, to reveal the truth to us, Lord God. And Lord, it's your Son Jesus who gave us the example of how we should live a life that surrenders our will to your will. Not my will, but thy will be done. And Lord, that we should be open to being used by you in any way you choose to use us. That we submit to you totally, entirely, and completely. Use our lives in anything that you put in our lives for your glory and for the blessing of others. We just praise you and thank you for this time we've had in your word. In Jesus Christ's precious name. Amen and amen. So, I'm glad you're with us. It's been a blessing. I'm glad you were with us. It's a blessing. And I'm sure before we go, Alice once again wants to say,
Jesus loves you
a lot. So until next time, God bless you and goodbye.